1996 Atlanta Games, the Brazilian won the last day confrontation, forcing Ainsley over the line before the start gun. That was in the final race, and it disqualified Ainsley and pushed him into silver medal position. But Scheid was aware of Ainsley's development.
After the silver medal, he got two laser world championships and a lot of European championships. So I think he's very mature now, and I think it's going to come down to who does the best day tomorrow.
Where Robert Scheid was leading Ben Ainsley in the penultimate race. Scheid had defended his laser world championship performances three times and looks set to successfully defend his Olympic gold medal too. Would Ainsley have to settle for silver again? As Scheid finished in second, his body language said it all. He believed that he was on target for gold. Ainsley finished fifth. It was a result that left him with everything to do in the last race. The crux of the matter being that if he'd finished one place further back, gold would have been impossible. Now, to win gold, Ainsley had two options: win the race and hope that Scheid finished ninth or worse, or hassle Scheid and stop him finishing better than 22nd.
1 minute to go to the start. Robert Scheid looks behind. Ainsley is just inches behind him. And look at Ainsley's eyes looking under that sail.
And it seems like Ben Ainsley's got a protest flag out at the moment. That could be an incident between him and Robert Scheid that he may be seeking to take further in the jury later on. That's a very interesting development. It may be that Ainsley's already had an upper hand.
So Ainsley has a protest, so whatever happens in this race, there is a possibility it may go to the protest room. Final countdown. Robert Scheid pulls slightly ahead, 20 seconds to go. Scheid has Argentina just behind him. He may accelerate and just try and escape out of the grasp of Ainsley. 12 seconds to go. Well, Ainsley's struggling there to force him over.
Ainsley's really got in controlling position here.
That's the start. Well, Ainsley was in control. He's in the middle of the line. And there is the Brazilian. Well, he's jibed round. This is like America's Cup match racing. Ignore the other race. It doesn't matter to these two. That is quite extraordinary. That is like a Formula One start with two of the cars doing circles whilst everyone else goes round the track.
And now, basically, Ben is now just looking to capitalise on his position in relation to the Brazilian. He just wants to make sure that at every opportunity, he never gives the Brazilian a chance to get in front of any boats around the racetrack.
Far from safe, Ben Ainsley. Long way to go in this race. And both Ainsley and Scheid have proved that they can shift into a different gear that none of these boats possess. If Scheid gets past Ainsley, there's every chance he can get into the top 20. So look at Ainsley now. He's got Scheid at the back of the pack. That's still not good enough. He's going to try and slow him down. The leader went round this mark about 3 minutes ago. And this is extraordinary. Ainsley has let his sail out. Scheid is trying to escape. This is exactly like cat and mouse. Scheid is going to try and turn round and do a jump. Scheid is sailing the other way down the racetrack because he can't escape. That's all right, says Ainsley. I'll go back and get you another way. Well, Scheid was one sailor of the year, and Ben Ainsley is having him for breakfast right now.
Ainsley at the moment is just trying to hold the Brazilian, just hold him out. The Brazilian is no right of way here. Ben has got all the rights in the world, and he's allowed to just sail and keep the Brazilian from going round the buoy.
This is
That's
incredible.
What he's doing. He's just chasing him downwind, chasing him away from the buoy.
Right.
Incident.
That is confrontation. There was a collision there. There's already a protest on Ainsley. Your call on that.
It's such a close call there. Basically, it looked to me that the Brazilian just jibed in Ben's water, as it's termed in sailing. He was causing a manoeuvre in Ben's water and didn't give him enough time to get out of the way.
Probably thought that he was in a very good position to win from there. And then suddenly to realise that I was really going to try my best to stop him and that it wasn't going to be easy for him. And then having to deal with the different rule scenarios and the fact that I was just trying to push him all over the course and, you know, just sort of rattled him, really.
it was all revolves around on the discard, and I could see Ben's scores. He had this at the shot, had this other high score which Ben didn't have, and although the Brazilian was actually leading by quite a long, I think maybe 10 points, Ben still had this in the bag, and I felt then that Ben would actually be able to overtake him by using that in his sort of weaponry, so to speak.
There were only really two options. One was to go out, win the race, and hope Robert didn't do too well, and the other option was to sail Robert down.
It was no coincidence that after that Olympics at Atlanta, Ben went away and did some match racing with some really good British match racing guys, and learned, you know, how to control those situations. So he came in to the last race. He was, you know, he knew full well that he had the tools in a box to do the job.
Ben's result in the first of the races of that last day were really important. Had he finished one place further behind Robert in that first race, he wouldn't have had the chance to win a gold medal anyway.
We all knew the points difference was huge, and Ben really had an uphill struggle to get it in the final race, and we were all just glued around the telly.
It's all about probability, and the probability was that Ben might not win the race, but certainly that Robert wouldn't be nine places behind him, because he never had been.
I think there was two starts before the start finally got away, and in each one he still had Robert Scheidt nailed at the start, and there's cheers out the Brits every time he did it, and he pulled it off again in the third and had everyone glued to the screens watching.
Ben was pretty psyched about it, and he knew that he's as capable as anyone.
The one thing I really remember is just how relentless he was.
And here comes Robert Scheidt. We'll get his finish position confirmed. Has he pulled up one place? There is the Brazilian on the right of your picture. Well, it seemed to me that Greece were behind him at the last mark. That's an encouraging sign. But have both Greece and Brazil overhauled other boats? This is a nail-biting finish for gold. What does his body language say? Does he think he's won? Now, the other issue is, on the water, if there is a disqualification in another protest, that could lift Scheidt's position up one or two places. So there'll be no celebrations out on the water.
I knew that something had happened at the start line, and, you know, you've perhaps seen on the film Ben's sort of looks to say, you know, have I done it? And I couldn't respond. I mean, I knew he'd done it mathematically, but I knew that there was likely to be protest between other boats, and that there was an incident.
I thought I'd done enough to win it, but obviously a lot depended on protests in the fleet, and I knew Robert was going to try and protest, so I didn't really want to start leaping about celebrating if it was all going to turn around at the end of the day.
We had to get in quickly, and we wanted to get on with the protest.
This was a very strange way to end an Olympic contest. Ainslie and Derbyshire were sure that the permutations had worked out on the water. But if any outstanding protests between other boats disqualified them and lifted Scheidt just one place, Brazil would take gold. It was a confusing moment for Ainslie. And despite the uncertainty, the British team were waiting to begin celebrations dockside. Ainslie was towed back to the dock to prepare for his protest. He was met by jubilant teammates.
He got to the pontoon, and everyone who wasn't actually sailing at the time was there. And we just picked him up in his boat above our heads and just carried him up the pontoon, clapping and cheering, and yeah, great Britain, Team GB, you know, just all the sort of God Save the Queen type, you know, nationalistic stuff came to mind at that point, and that moment was just incredible for me. Really sort of epitomised the whole team spirit and what the Olympics is all about. It's about sailing for your country.
Although Ainslie's celebrations were more muted than his teammates, it was still an outstanding feat of sailing and match racing he'd been able to deal out to the Brazilian. He was hoping his performance on the water would be enough to give him revenge.
I think one of the most frustrating things was people were, you know, cheering Ben, and I couldn't share in that, and Ben was finding it difficult, but kind of had to do it.
All these cameras are there, and it's just, you know, what do you think? How does it feel? And I was, you know, trying to, obviously I was happy the way it had gone, but I still wasn't sure I'd won, so I was just trying to keep a lid on it all, really.
Ainslie reasoned that the protest between him and Scheidt would have no bearing on the outcome of the Olympics, and asked the Brazilian to drop the action. But Scheid remained resolute. The proceedings went on into the night. Even for an experienced Olympic team manager, this was a big moment.
Experience of sitting there watching the two top laser sailors in the world, who I've seen countless times on the water, and for the first time seeing them both in a protest room with a lot at stake, was one that will remain with me for quite a long time.
The protest went Ainsley's way. Scheid was disqualified. Britain, gold in the laser class, and Ainsley, Olympic champion.